Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 10th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2024. The first item for the committee to consider is whether to take agenda items 4, 5, 6 and 7 in private. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed, thank you. The next item on our agenda is consideration of the 2022-23 audit of the Water Industry Commission for Scotland. We've got a number of witnesses with us this morning, both from the Scottish Government and from the Water Industry Commission, so you're very welcome. In turn, we have Roy Brannan, who is the Director General of Net Zero. Along with him is Kirsty Burge, who's the Director of Energy and Climate Change in the Scottish Government, and John Rathjen, who's the Deputy Director of Water Policy and in the Directorate for Energy and Climate Change Operations. We're also joined this morning by the Chair of the Board of WICS, Professor Donald McRae, who is joined by Robin McGill, who is another member of the Board, and the Chair of the Audit and Risk Committee. We are also joined by David Satie, who is the, well, he's down here as the Director of Strategy and Governance at the Water Industry Commission. But I know, as of yesterday, Mr. Satie, you were appointed as the Interim Accountable Officer. So we'll be asking you questions in that capacity too this morning. We've got quite a number of questions that we want to put. But before we get to those, I'm going to invite, first of all, Roy Brannan and then Mr. McRae to make a short opening statement each. So, Mr. Brannan, over to you, Director General.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Committee. Thanks for the invitation to attend the Committee today. I'm joined today by two colleagues, Kirsty Burge, Director of Energy and Climate Change, and John Rathjen, Deputy Director for Water Policy, with sponsorship oversight responsibility for WICS. It's important at the outset to say that the Scottish Government fully accepts the findings and recommendations by Audit Scotland and in the Audit General's Section 22 report on the Water Industry Commission for Scotland's 22-23 annual accounts. We recognise the seriousness of this report and are working to ensure that each recommendation is fully addressed. The team are focused on supporting WICS to resolve the governance issues and strengthen its financial management according to Audit Scotland's recommendations. In terms of Scottish Government oversight, we are also focused on strengthening the sponsorship relationship. Our primary focus is to ensure that WICS regains stakeholders' and public's trust as an economic regulator, where we've seen WICS operating technically as an effective economic regulator. This is evidenced by the around 35% efficiency gains it's helped to achieve from Scottish Water through its economic oversight since 2005. This is particularly important given the combined challenges facing us, including assets, increasing climate change and the cost of living crisis. As always, we'll endeavour to answer the committee's questions today and follow up in writing if we're unable to do so.
Thanks, Director General. Mr. McRae, over to you.
Well, good morning, Leader and Committee. WICS accepts the need for a greater focus on value for money and the need to operate to the highest standards of financial management. Today, I want to tell you about the changes at WICS since last December to meet those needs. WICS is the economic regulator of Scottish Water, but it supports the hydronation strategy of Scottish Government to the extent of generating international income of £1.2 million in the last financial year, and that's 22% of total income. What changes have taken place at WICS since December last year? Well, the CEO and accountable officer, one and the same person, resigned effective from 31st December, and that has allowed us to achieve a change of culture and a rapid refocus on value for money. We have appointed, as you've heard, an interim CEO and an interim accountable officer, who's now sitting beside me. We have reinstated our approvals panel to ensure that any significant expenditure, or all significant expenditure, has the required approvals in place. We have also revised our policies on travel and expenses with the focus on compliant expenses claims to move towards a target of 0% expense claims with no receipt from the 4.4% of expense claims or 1 in 23 experienced during the year 22-23. Now, there is a lot more But in summary, we have agreed 27 actions, all opposite all the issues raised by Audit Scotland. And of these 27, 24 are now complete. My colleagues here today are David Satie, who is now the interim CEO and interim accountable officer, and Robin McGill, who is the chair of the Audit and Risk Committee. So we're happy to answer your questions, convener.
Okay, thank you. I mean, just on that last point, I think it would be useful for us to get sight of those actions that you have undertaken and understand what progress you have made on them. So it would be helpful, I think, for us to get to be able to see that. I mean, I hear what's been said about the role of WICS and what it's done to bring in extra revenue, etc. But I think the focus of the Section 22 report is about conduct, behaviour, appropriate action and so on. I mean, I think reference was made to the governance framework, which, as I understand it, was last reviewed in April 2022, which kind of ironically is the start of the period under scrutiny by Audit Scotland, which has turned up some quite concerning findings. I mean, the Auditor General described it to us as significant weaknesses in the governance and financial management arrangements. He believed it fell far short. There were things which he identified as coming up, which really, I think, stood out for him because he'd never seen the like before or rarely seen the like before in a public body, and we'll get into some of that during the course of this morning. But what if governance is the overarching structure and strategy that provides accountability and direction, and that influences the behaviours and culture within WICS, which is the very first sentence of the governance framework of WICS, how have we got to the situation that's reported in this Section 22 report?
So I think the framework document reviewed back in 22 by John and Kirsty and the team, I think reflects the ongoing relationship we've got in terms of all our public bodies and making sure that our framework documents are regularly reviewed. I think the issues that have been raised by Audit Scotland in particular would appear to be a lack of adherence with the policies set down in the framework document, and that's really a question for Donald, the board and the risk committee, and indeed the new chief executive. But my once it was made aware of the issues in December, early December, I sought immediately to speak to Donald directly on the back of the report and asked for an implementation action plan to be put in place, which is what Donald just talked about there. So 27 actions over 13 areas to try and address the areas around governance, controls, policies, procedures, reporting, and a couple of other issues around the estates themselves. But I don't know if John or Kirsty, you want to say anything about the framework?
I think just say, I mean, the framework was put in place, it was discussed, and it was published on the Commission's website. So I think there was no doubt about it being in force in that sense. So, and it was a direct response to the Ryan report to put those frameworks in place, and that's been an active piece of work across government to make sure those are all in place. So I don't think there's any doubt about its being in force.
Well, I think, Mr. Rathen, there precisely is doubt about whether it was in force. I don't think there's any doubt that it was on the website. I don't think there's any doubt that there's a written document that exists. But I think there's a huge question mark about whether the standards of governance and the standards of behaviour and the systems that were in place match up to the intention that's set out in the governance document. I'm going to bring other members of the committee in, but before I do, can I just check something off with you? Again, in the opening to the governance framework reviewed April 22, it does say Scottish ministers have the power to direct, or the power of Scottish ministers to direct the Water Industry Commission is confined to matters relating to the WICS financial management and administration. Has a minister been involved in what's happened here?
Yes, so our minister has been notified of, as soon as we had heard of the Section 22 report, Kirsty and the team notified our minister, cabinet secretary, of the contents of the Section 22, and she's been closely involved all the way through in terms of the appointment of the new chief executive.
But she wasn't involved, for example, in signing off the authorisation which Mr. Rathjen gave to the £77,000 Harvard Business School course?
No.
Okay, okay, right. I'm going to invite Colin Beattie to put some questions to you.
Thank you, Vera. Since we've just mentioned the 77,350, let me focus on that to begin with. Chief Operating Officer attending a training course in Harvard Business School in Boston. How robust was the business case that was prepared for this course, and what options were considered? I'm not going to ask any particular person. If the appropriate person can just respond.
Well, convener, I will start off answering that question, and then I will probably ask David to follow up. Wix is, as you've heard, is a small public body operating in a very complex and specialised area, and we do find it difficult to compete on salaries with the private sector, and actually to retain staff, and our staff are frequently subject to approaches, being poached actually. Now, we recognise that our staff are our most important asset, and we take the view that we have to invest in them, and we have to invest in them by offering advanced management training. Now, in this case that you've referred to, the Harvard Business Training, we accept completely that the value for money was not fully demonstrated, and the business case was inadequate. So how do we proceed going forward? Well, we will still adhere to the policy of investing in our staff, but we would ask for any such proposal in future to be given a much more robust business case, and almost certainly be asked to produce the training internally from either within Scotland or the UK at much lower cost and, frankly, better value for money. David, I don't know, do you want to explain how this process happened?
More than happy to explain. So in spring 2021, initial discussions with the CEO and COO took place around personal development. And at that time, they also included, as I understand, UK institutions. But then, over the coming months, a preference was highlighted by the CEO for institutions in the US. And then a business case was submitted for the course in question.
Why was that preference? Was it the quality of the course or what?
So, Mr. Beattie, I wasn't a part of those discussions, so I couldn't say accurately as to why there was that preference for the US. But one of the actions that Donald spoke to was the reinstatement of the approvals panel, so that there is that collective conversation on expenditure such as this going forward.
Would it be possible to get a copy of the business case? I realise that. Mr. McCrae's already said it was inadequate, but it would be interesting to see the document itself and what the whole thing was based on.
Of course, more than happy to.
Can you run through what the approval process was for that particular piece of expenditure, as it happened and as it should have been?
Sure.
Could I just start off with a quick response to that before David answers more fully? But this is a really important point. Going forward, I would very much like the approvals panel to make a decision and judgment on such a proposition and call it under the heading of novel and contentious. And this is the judgment that was missing in this case, because if they had found this to be a novel and contentious decision, they should have asked the board, we weren't asked actually, should have asked the board to approve. And we would have then made sure that all the relevant questions were asked about value for money. David, sorry, I interrupted you responding.
No, more than happy to. So Mr. Beattie, as I was saying, in spring 21, there was a conversation around personal development, and advanced management courses were highlighted as a need. And as I said, over the coming months, there was a narrowing of the institutions. And then in April 2022, the CEO prepared an approval form for the course, and we're more than happy to send you that approval form. This was approved by the CEO, as the Auditor General highlighted when he presented evidence. At the time, there wasn't that group conversation, to Donald's point, around the approval panel, where the value for money case was challenged, or indeed the route to market challenged, or the subsequent approvals discussed and agreed among the decision makers within the organisation. And that's the reason why we have reinstated an approval panel, to ensure that such items of expenditure is subjected to that scrutiny going forward.
I hear what you say. Clearly, there were many deficiencies in this, not just the business case itself, but the whole approval process. I'll move on slightly, because I think some of my colleagues will probably pick up on this again. But what was the decision-making process in regard to the Christmas gift vouchers, which in total cost £2,600, £100 for each member of staff, and it was a taxable benefit that I think was later picked up by the Commission. What was the actual decision-making process and the approval process that was carried through?
You should.
Yeah, more than happy to. So, similar at the time when the decision was taken to give staff £100 vouchers, a purchase order. The total quantum of this amount was less than the £10,000 threshold in place for an approval form. So a purchase order was then put in place and signed off by the budget holder and the CEO at the time. But again, coming back to the reinstatement of the approval panel, this is something that would be deemed novel and contentious, even though it's below the £10,000 threshold. Given the point that Audit Scotland had made when they presented evidence, given the £75 limit for gift threshold, this would then required both board approval and government approval. So this wasn't something that was subjected to an approval panel process similar to the Harvard course. But going forward, we will put such expenditure subjected to an approval panel process.
Can I just be clear on one thing? The information you're giving us is second-hand, isn't it? It wasn't your personal...
I wasn't part of the discussions related to the gifts, Mr. Beattie.
So where did the information come from that you're giving us now?
So it came from subsequent preparations from colleagues ahead of today.
Okay. Isn't it a bit unusual for a public body to give staff members Christmas vouchers?
Well, Mr. Beattie, if I could start off the answer to that. You must remember the situation. We were in a situation where we were all operating remotely and still in the process of recovering from COVID. That was the background to the decision. But David, do you want to get some more detail?
My commitment to you, Mr. Beattie, is that going forward we won't be giving staff any vouchers going forward at Christmas.
My question was, is it normal? Is there precedence in public bodies giving such vouchers to staff?
Yeah, well, I can't say concretely that's not the case, but it's unusual in terms of any of the public bodies that I have had dealings with, but I guess that's a question that we could come back to and check to see whether the public body landscape across the whole of Scottish Government adhere to a kind of normal process of public sector.
It would be interesting to know if there are other cases such as this.
I'm not aware of any, no. Mm.
And just another angle on that, do we have any examples of payments being made by the Commission that have resulted in personal tax implications?
Yes, indeed. And David, I think you have the examples in detail.
Yes, we undertook a review of our expenses during the 22 during 22, and as part of that review, we had independent tax experts look at the expense policy to deem whether any of the items could be seen as a taxable benefit, and certain items were seen in this light, such as the reimbursement or contribution of personal eye care glasses, for example, Mr. Beattie. That was seen as a taxable benefit, which led to the PAYE settlement agreement to proactively disclose that to HMRC and pay for the tax related to those items.
So during that period, if I worked for the Water Industry Commission, I'd be able to get my specs for free, get it reimbursed up to what value?
So the expenses policies in place at that time was to reimburse a proportion of the eye care that staff would pay for.
What proportion?
I would have to get back to you on the exact. I don't wear glasses. It's not something that I have reimbursed. So I would have to get back to you on the exact allowance.
You mentioned that as one example. What other examples do you have?
So,
I mean, how wide ranging is this reimbursement policy?
So, the other examples would include things like a leave and lunch for a member of staff if they departed the organisation, or it's items such as that, Mr. Beattie. I wouldn't say it was wide ranging.
Could you give us a list of all the items that were subject to this?
Yes, more than happy to write to the convener and provide the items that would be deemed potentially taxable.
And presumably the tax implications arising from this policy, personal tax was dealt with by the Commission?
At that point in time, the personal tax was dealt by the Commission, but as part of the work plan that we have put in place, we have made it clear that going forward, that WICs will not be paying for any tax or NI on such items of expenditure.
And I'm pleased to hear it, but as an audit committee, of course, we tend to look backwards at what's happened and try to interpret that. How aware was the board and the audit and risk committee members? How aware were they of this expenditure that was being carried out like this? Was there an approval process at all for individual members of staff? Was that just done at a departmental level? Was there an equivalent of some sort of HR committee or that looked at these personal items? How was it handled?
Is that about the particular case of glasses, or
it's about anything that raised the personal tax implication,
right,
and anything that was a benefit to staff that perhaps is out of line with what other public bodies are doing?
Okay, well, perhaps David can answer, and perhaps Robin may want to come in.
Yeah. Sure. So the process when we undertook the review of expenses, as an example, this was presented to the Audit and Risk Committee, and the Audit and Risk Committee then approves that and recommends it to the board.
So each individual transaction or the policy?
The policy itself, the policy. Mr. Beattie.
And who approves the actual items?
That would be a managerial decision, provided it adheres to the policy.
So there was delegated powers down to whatever managerial level it came to, and they made the decision that the staff member qualified, but there was no consideration of implication of tax at that point.
So the at that point in time, it was delegated to the manager and provided it adhered to the policy. Then the manager approved it.
So presumably, if the Audit and Risk Committee laid down policy, how aware was the board of this policy?
Could I just suggest that maybe Robin McGill, who's the chair of the Audit and Risk Committee, address that issue?
Yeah, Mr. Beattie, I mean, I'll link it back to something Donald said earlier on. I mean, the CEO at the time had this view, and we kind of shared that view. It was very hard to recruit talented staff. So there was a feeling that we need to have a package of measures to retain the staff that we have. And that kind of sits within that general view that, well, that sounds like a good thing, but certainly as opposed to the cost of recruiting and turning over staff and everything else. And that was the background for some of that. So if the change in the policy came to the Audit and Risk Committee for us to review the policy. We didn't review individual items like that in the sense that here's an invoice, are we going to approve it? That was very much down the line through budget centres and everything else. But the general policy with certain items in it was deemed that as part of an overall staff retention policy, this was a good idea. And now we're changing our mind. But anyway, that's going forward.
How was the board appraised of that?
I'm not sure. Well, in the sense that we would recommend to the board that this suite of policies, which have been changed, we would say we're content with them and the board should review them. And there's nothing that we've seen that would cause us to say to the board, don't approve them.
So in this case, the board did approve
the policies,
these package of measures.
Can I just answer that? As chair of the board, we had a report from the Audit and Risk Committee at regular intervals throughout the year, and the policy would on that issue would have been among all the reports that came to the board. And the board were reassured by the Audit and Risk Committee's report.
But the board would have actually approved that policy?
The board did approve the policy, yes, of course.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks. I think Graham Simpson's got some more questions in line with that. Graham.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks very much, convener. Mr. Brannan, if I can turn to you first, because Mr. Beattie was asking about taxable benefits, and we heard that staff at the Commission were able to claim glasses, for example. In the rest of the Scottish Government, do these kind of benefits exist?
I was trying to recollect there. I think there is something, and I need to come back to you, but there is something about reasonable adjustments in terms of being able to work. And certainly eye tests, I seem to remember there was a case for eye tests, but I would need to check that and come back to you exactly what the policy is in Scottish Government on those kind of issues. I don't have it to hand.
But you can get that for us?
Yes, yeah.
There might be more than just eye tests. There might be other benefits.
Well, professional fees, for instance, are usually, in some circumstances, paid for, and that is set down in policies. So there's quite clear policies, both in the SPFM, but also more generally across HR, in terms of employee benefits, employee, and the things that can be claimed. So that's all pretty evident. It can be sent to the committee if necessary.
Okay. And you said earlier that you weren't sure whether there was anywhere else in government that gave Christmas gifts to staff.
Certainly not something that I've come across, but again, it's a wide public body sector. I've got 28 public bodies that come under me. I couldn't sit here today and say categorically that hasn't happened. I do know in the UK government, for instance, there is a reward system that individuals can get if a team has performed particularly well on a particular task. So again, there may be examples elsewhere, but I just couldn't say for sure.
But you'll go away now and check all the people underneath you whether that is.
I will endeavour to get an answer to that, in a summary form if I can, in terms of the public bodies that I'm aware of. Yeah.
Okay, I want to go back to this Harvard trip. Mr. Rathjen, is that the correct pronunciation?
Yes, thanks.
Rathjen. Okay. We've got a couple of bits of correspondence here, which have your name on it. So there was an email. Actually, it was an email from you, I think. Yes, you write on the 3rd of November 2023 to Alan, who I presume is the former chief exec. You're writing about this training course, and you say, had I been informed, I would have agreed with the approach. So why would you have agreed with the approach?
So I think, first up, we need to say
this should have, a business case should have come to us ahead of the expenditure being made, and we should have had the full facts of both the approach and the benefits of the course, and could then have scrutinised that properly. And I think we'll certainly have challenged the base of whether or not it should be a UK provider or an international one. So it's highly unusual to be asked to approve expenditure retrospectively. I've never seen that before and been asked to approve retrospectively. So I have to say my mindset at the time was very clearly on this expenditure has been made. This was in the accounts. It was revealed in the accounts. So it was a retrospective issue, and that is highly unusual. In agreeing the approach, that refers to the single tender, which is really why it should have come to government ahead of time. So the mistake that was made, I think, was that it was assumed to be within the WICS delegated powers to make the decision on value for money and so on and so forth and approve the business case. But in fact, because they used a single tender approach, it should have come to government with a business case for our appraisal. But my approval of it was essentially that this money had been spent. So there was no material benefit at that point in challenging it.
Well, you could have challenged it. You could have pushed back. You could have said, this was inappropriate. This was far too much money. And part of the approach, revealed in another email to you, was that the COO identified Harvard. This is the COO who went to Harvard, identified Harvard as her preferred option. So she got to pick where she was going to go. That's part of the approach that you've just said is okay. It's not okay, is it?
No. I think I was assured by the CEO that the course best met the needs of the individual, and he also assured me that the costs were comparable with other providers. I think, you know, look, in retrospect, it's an error of judgment not to have pressed for more information on those points. I think, to repeat, you know, this was being asked of us retrospectively to the event happening. We had no material way of changing the outcome. And that's a highly unusual place to be.
And if I can just build on that point and something I said right at the start. So from what I can see, this is a failure in the policies, on the application of the policies. So the framework was pretty clear about the responsibilities for the board, the chair, the chief executive and the sponsor team. And in this case, the delegated authorities were breached and the proper process wasn't followed. And as John has said, a bad error in judgment not to have continued the challenge at that time. But it was beyond the point of us being able to influence it. This course happened at the start of the year. First we were made, John was made aware of it was when it came forward in the Section 22 report. So again, it comes back to, I guess, the bit that I am encouraged on, and Donald and the team are taking forward, is the immediate action plan on the back of those issues raised by Audit Scotland and actually addressing things that are in governance, the policies, the procedures, and the reporting, which is the really important thing. I want to get back, WICS back to being the point of a really well-governed public body, and that's the, I think, for me, that's the important thing.
Okay. All right, so I accept, Mr. Rathdren, you accept that you should have pushed back, you should have said this was unacceptable, and you didn't. So that's fine, you admit there was an error, and you should have done that. But that goes, to me, that is part of the culture that existed at the time, that nobody was saying, this is wrong. Do you accept that point?
I think, you know, what I did push back on was that the novel and contentious expenditure was absolutely should have been brought to our attention. It was not acceptable not to do that. And that retrospection was also, you know, simply not acceptable as well. So, and certainly on the gift vouchers, for example, that was against the framework agreement and was therefore clearly unacceptable. So I think, you know, could I push back harder? Yes. I could have pushed back harder. Did I push back? Yes. I highlighted in particular that point about novel and contentious expenditure, which is really the point here is that I think internally the culture around that kind of expenditure should have been, there should have been a better culture of thinking about things from how it would be perceived outside of at the public body. How would people see those kind of expenditures? And I think that's, you know, that was the bit that I was trying to make clear, was that that, you know, the thought process around novel and contentious was really the issue. And that, okay, this was picked out of an, you know, the internal auditor highlighted this and brought it out, and then further the auditor general also brought it out. But that's obviously far too late in the process. These things, there should be a proper appraisal of these things with formal business cases, really making sure that value for money was key to decision making. So I think we were clear about that. And I said it's just highly unusual to have to deal with these things retrospectively. It's not something we've seen elsewhere.
The committee's heard that within the commission there were, maybe there still are, a number of people who have credit cards which apparently have no limit on spending. You just go out and spend what you like on these cards. Is that still the case?
Well, Convener, Mr. Simpson, could I start the answer by saying that we recognise that there is some action required on cards, and we have taken that. However, I'd like to point out that senior staff having cards is not unusual, and it's pretty important given how we all operate these days. We do recognise, of course, that it does mean that our processes and checks and culture have to be correctly aligned to ensure proper operation. Now, David, can you tell us, we have taken some action with regards to cards, which I think will be very helpful.
Yeah, more than happy to. So at the time, and this was also highlighted when the Auditor General presented evidence, many of the items of expenditure, including expenses, were incurred in office credit cards. These cards were issued to the senior leadership and certain members of the operational staff, but also some of the individuals undertaking the international consultancy work. Since the issues are identified by the Auditor General and the work plan that we have put in place, those credit cards have been frozen. Members of staff will incur expenses on their own cards, and they will only be reimbursed if that expenditure is compliant going forward, Mr. Simpson.
So we've got rid of these corporate credit cards. You said they were frozen. Are we just getting rid of them?
They're frozen only because there still might be instances where expenditure on a credit card is deemed appropriate. For example, the purchase of IT. So if there is a business case put forward ex ante and the expenditure justified, then the credit card would be unlocked and the expenditure incurred on the card. So there are greater controls for this small and the subset of individuals that would incur items of expenditure on the card.
And Mr. Brannan wants in.
Yeah, one of the things that we'll be doing going forward with the sponsor team and David and Donald and the board will be to look at the policies around credit cards. So in Scottish Government, we have electronic purchasing cards. The policy was redone just at the start of the year. Three separations, card holder, authoriser and card controller. And I think that there's a lot of learning that can be done from what we do in core Scottish Government for the public body before they start to reintroduce the need for a credit card. There is an opportunity to get a TNS credit card within Scottish Government, but again, there are very strict rules about how that's used and adapted, and one of the clear exclusions on it is no drink policy. So again, I think there's a lot of learning that can be taken before David moves too much forward into this interim position, to just make sure that the policies are as up-to-date as possible and in alignment with both SPFM but also government policy.
Okay, so one of the problems with this system is that people were able to go out and spend money and they weren't asked to provide receipts. And we heard of one example of where the former chief executive went for a meal with a water industry person from New Zealand. This was in October 2022 at the Champagnat Inn in Linlithgow, and the total cost for that meal for two was £402.41. Now, you know, I've been struggling to work out how you could arrive at such a figure for two people. So I've had before I get into it, do you actually know what was eaten or consumed that night?
Could I commence the answer, and I'm sure we will have further details supplied by both David and Robin. The meal was indeed held at the Champagne Inn at Linlithgow. It was the former CEO with a senior official from the New Zealand government. It was paid for by the CEO with a credit card. It was wrongly coded subsequently as subsistence when it should have been coded up as business development. It was part of our hydronation strategy, and it was part of a series of contacts with overseas visitors, and the New Zealand contact was instrumental, not wholly instrumental, but was part of the contact that led up to the development of that 1.2 million of income, which I referred to earlier. Having said that, I completely accept that we did not show value for money on this event, in this case, and in future we have changed the rules to make sure that we do demonstrate better value for money. So the policy would now, for such an event, states that such expenditure would have to be pre-approved. As you've heard, we've reduced the number of credit cards in use, and it would be correctly coded up under business development. But there's one last point I want to make, and it refers to the last point that you made, Mr. Simpson, about the culture, because having rules is very useful, but culture on when to obey the rules is actually more important, and that's where I want to see major change. And we have sought to do that by having training in value for money for our senior staff, and by making sure that that is rolled out to all members of WICS, so that when they come to look at a proposition such as this in future, they will take the view this could be novel or should be novel and contentious, and will seek further approval. Now, well, David, do you want to give some more detail on the actual? Do you want detail on the actual process, or?
Well, yeah, because I've been looking at the menu at this fine establishment, and you know, if you look. If you pick the most expensive item, starter, main course, and dessert, cold smoked salmon, £12.95 a head. Then we move on to the Chateaubriand, £16 per 100 kilos. So if you get the minimum weight of 800, that's £128 for two people. Then you move on to a cheese course, £14.50. That all adds up to £202.90. That's for food. Where does the rest come from? You know, I would have thought somebody should have been querying this bill.
Well, could I suggest that David answer first, and then I'll go to Robin, who actually looked at this expense.
So, as the chair highlighted, this was a dinner attended by the former CEO and a delegate from the New Zealand government, and the expenditure didn't incur, it wasn't provided with an itemised receipt. So we have no way of knowing, Mr. Simpson, the exact items that was purchased. It was reimbursed on an office credit card. And these are some of the items that going forward we will not allow. So items of expenditure will be incurred on personal credit cards and only reimbursed if an itemised receipt is provided and compliant with policies.
Mm. Mr. Satti, it's unbelievable. No, nobody thought to question it. But now you would, but nobody at the time thought to question this.
Robin will give us more detail.
Mr. Simpson, I can assure you at the time I challenged this. One, in the first instance, because it came through coded as subsistence, and I said, this is ridiculous, and I sent it back and refused to sign it off. Then I had a discussion with the CEO about the nature of the meeting, what it was supporting, and took a view that in the context of business development, a very lucrative business development, although it was eye-watering, it was a legitimate expense. So it was challenged at the time, absolutely. And I also took every opportunity to speak to the CEO every time anything like this happened to reinforce the need for itemised receipts, because it just leads you to wonder, as I was wondering, what on earth did you spend this on?
But what was the answer, Mr. McGill?
Well, he was just saying it was a business expense, it enabled this business, and it was good value for money. And it serves to demonstrate where he was thinking it was. And I had many occasions to say to him, you know, it's not all about the bottom right-hand corner on the accounts. You've got to be seen to be doing the right thing. And through my ARC meetings, we had regular conversations about public reaction to excessive spend. So they were challenged at the time, and a lot of pushback, but we kept that challenge on. But maybe, as a convener, if you'll allow me just a minute to give some context to the whole expenses thing. Now, Audit Scotland did sampling, and we've actually gone right down to the bottom. We've been through thousands and thousands of transactions. We can give you the latest update, if you like. And it's slightly different, but it basically says that of all of those expenses that came through, 92.5% were itemised and fully compliant. So a lot of people who were working were doing the right thing, getting them approved, getting the right documentation, and that was good. It's worth noting that the monetary value of those 92.5% of transactions was 99% of the total value of transactions put through. The transactions that were not compliant amount to about 162, just slightly more in the period, and 58 of them were relating to non-itemised receipts. So I just wanted to make the point that there was a lot of people at Wix doing the right thing, and they were doing the right thing and going about their business, and there was a few people at Wix not doing the right thing. I just thought that context might be helpful for the committee.
A few people, how many?
Sorry?
How many?
If you do an 80-20, it's probably two or three people account for most of the non-itemised receipts.
Two or three people. So will the
CEO and a couple of others.
Well, who are the other two?
Again, I don't want to actually, but there were senior directors who presented expense claim forms without receipts, and those we are following up. But it's still a very small number, and the value was basically, I think it comes up to the CEO was accountable for nearly half of these.
Yeah. Are the other two people still with the organisation?
Well, they are.
They are.
And I think it comes to culture. It's a question of why were they behaving that way when they knew perfectly well that that wasn't the right thing to do. And I say now the CEO has departed. I'm pleased to say in January and February we had zero non-compliance in expenses and reports. So I think the organisation has made a real shift. The action plan that's been delivered has also made a real shift towards tighter, no alcohol, and pre-approval of anything that supports is contentious, because there's a lot of tension between running a domestic regulator, small body, and running an international consultancy in terms of approach. And we've been trying to fit that into one policy, and it's very hard, and we'll take advice from the support group going forward. How can we do that? Because these tensions will continue as we go forward and pursue this business, so we need to get clear guidance.
I've got one final question, Convener. I know I've had quite a long time here, but are you still sending people off to New Zealand? And if so, are they flying economy, or are they going business class or first class? Did they do that before?
No one ever went first class.
Business class?
Business class. The policy currently states an over 6-hour flight, you're allowed to book business class. And obviously going to New Zealand is a long, long flight.
Nice work if you can get it.
Right, thank you. Mr. Rathjen, I want to go back to you, because I feel as though you're almost misleading the committee. Because you've said that, yes, you believed it was an error of judgment, and that you thought what was going on was not acceptable. But when I read the email that you send, you are saying things like, I'm grateful for the opportunity to comment on the Christmas gifts. I accept this was an oversight. I do not think it's proportionate to try and recover the balance on the training costs. I rather agree that this is a unique training offering and can see why single tender was your approach. I would have agreed with the approach. Due diligence had been carried out. I mean, that doesn't tell me that you're challenging that decision. That tells me you're going along with the decision. You're complicit in what many people looking at this now understand it to be a waste of public money.
So what I was saying was that I felt that the Commission should clearly have come with a business case to us ahead of the expenditure being made, and that what I was concerned about was that they had not done that. They'd not brought that fact to us at a point where we could make a material difference to it. So I was then given assurance by the CEO that all the due diligence had been done, it was the right thing to do. And when I'm saying I made an error of judgment, it's the error of judgment to have relied on that assurance at that point that he gave me. But again, I could make no material difference to the outcome at this point. That's the point is the retrospection is the issue.
But even with the benefit of that hindsight, you don't challenge it. In fact, you agree with it. And then in turn, you authorise the expenditure. You had it in your gift to turn that down. That was an option open to you, wasn't it?
I could have rejected the expenditure, but again, it would have made no material difference to do so. It had already been incurred. It was a months ago.
Okay. So, I mean, could somebody tell me what this chief operating officer does? And why do they need £77,000 worth of training?
It's a matter of the Commission, yeah.
Well, can I start the answer then, Convener? As I explained, there is a policy of offering senior advanced management training to senior members at Wickes for all the reasons of keeping staff, retaining staff, and making sure that we can offer an attractive package at all times and in the future. So this was part of that policy. I have to say, though, of course, as I said, that the policy was enacted through the CEO particularly, and he did have a preference for what's called North American courses, MIT, Harvard, so on. And I'm sure you know, Convener, that Harvard does have a particular high value in the whole world of education and management and business schools. Having said all that, I do think that there was room for a much greater and much better business case to be produced, and I'd look to that in the future.
I mean, you are an experienced, very experienced economics professor. Joe Armstrong, who was on Mr. McGill's audit committee, I think says in the CV she holds 2 economics degrees and is a business economist. So you're very familiar with the academic landscape. I mean, did you say earlier on you weren't aware of any of this at the time?
Well, the board were not asked to approve the Harvard business training course.
Okay.
I can categorically state that.
Okay.
The first we heard about it was on November the 2nd, which was well forward off the course had actually taken place by then.
But what's your view on the fact that we've been told that the only institutions that were considered for this course were Harvard, Stanford or Yale?
Well, I'm sitting not far from an institution that's awarded me 2 degrees in the past, so it'd be wrong of me to criticise any business school near at hand. In fact, I was a member of such a business school for a short period. But I think my main point is that we're not against such a policy of providing such a high level of managed education, but it must be produced with a definite business case, a robust business case, which proves value for money. And I can't say what the board would have said had we been given the choice, but I'm pretty certain we would have asked for a very much more robust business case than the one I eventually saw.
Well, the business case appears to be written by the person who was benefiting from the course, which is quite extraordinary. Can I move on to Mr. Brannan? I mean, what do we spend on the training of top civil servants in the Scottish Government on this kind of in this area?
I can't say for certain exactly what scale of courses are available, but you know, we use a lot of the courses that are provided through Cabinet Office, for instance, the Infrastructure Projects Authority on major projects and programming, Civil Service College. I mean, it's. I guess I can't comment on the individual or the learning and development gap or whether or not the gap was met by this course or not. But a bit like the chair, I would have expected to see a kind of wide range of offerings that were able to match the gap of development training that was required. But I couldn't say for certain whether there is nobody that's gone through a similar course in the Scottish Government. It's something that I've not come across in all my time in Scottish Government.
But you've not come across it. That's right. Okay, that's interesting. As I understand it as well, mentoring programmes and that kind of thing are part of the fabric of personal development, aren't they, within the civil service?
Mentoring, coaching, those are all available to members of the senior civil service and indeed everybody to benefit from, either from their cohort of senior colleagues or elsewhere within the UK government.
Yeah, and they don't cost £77,000, presumably. I guess one other final question I've got before I invite Willie Coffey to put some questions to you is, so this chief operating officer who's benefited from £77,000 of public expenditure to attend the Harvard Business School. I don't know how long the course lasted. But are they now, is there any kind of condition on that expenditure, which means they will stay with the organisation for a certain period of time? Or could they leave tomorrow?
Convener, I will start the question and answer. We normally do have such conditions, and David can give you some more detail on that. But in this case, there were no conditions applied that I'm aware of. David, do you want to give some examples of...
So in this course has lasted for slightly under 6 months. There have been instances where training opportunities of longer duration have been subjected to a lock-in for staff. Normally over a two-year period, Mr. Leonard. There have been instances in the past where a lock-in has been provided.
Well, maybe that was another facet of the business case that was drawn up by the chief operating officer herself. Willie Coffey, you've got some questions to put.
Thanks very much, convener. Good morning, colleagues. This is not particularly pleasant, this session. I've been a member of the Parliament and the Audit Committee on and off for 17 years now, and I would have to say to you colleagues that this is one of the worst sessions I've ever participated in, and I really have to be honest with you in saying that. I've just a few questions I'd like to ask, if I may, to Mr. Rathjen. Firstly, on the issue about whether the expense was retrospectively approved or not, I think you said ultimately it didn't make a difference because it had been incurred. Why would you do that, though? Why wouldn't you state your case and say that this is unapproved? You can't approve something that is clearly not approvable, if you understand my meaning. Why wouldn't you do that? Because ultimately the public would like to know what's the difference then between approving something or not approving it. If there's no outcome, no difference in outcome, what's the point?
I mean, because I suppose normally we would get a business case, we would have, it would be prior to the expenditure, and that would be the normal way we would see a novel and contentious expenditure come through, or something that was beyond the limits in the framework agreement set out for the organisation. So in that process, we would absolutely scrutinise the business case, we would go through the value for money, we would ask questions, we would press, and we would come to a judgment on the particular expenditure, and that would be the proper process, the normal way of doing it. This highly unusual to get a retrospective request. Essentially, it's a highlight from an audit that has said this should have been requested, and it gets noted. It was noted to government, but at that point, I sought the assurance of the chief executive about the appropriateness of the spend. I received that assurance, and I say my error of judgment, in a sense, was simply to accept that assurance at that point. But my mindset was this is a done deal. This expenditure is gone. So I will make the point that it should have come to us, that it should have been followed proper process, and that was my pushback to them essentially at that point. But there was no material change could be affected, so there wasn't really. Normally, there would absolutely be this sort of thing. We'd say no. You know, that's straightforward and push back on it because it would be very hard to see a business case that would justify that level of expenditure.
I'll come to the audit in a minute, but what would ha- happen if you had still not approved it? What would happen in government? What would happen? Surely something different happens between approving and not approving.
So my understanding, we can confirm this, is it would just be noted because the expenditure had already been undertaken, but we can check that.
There's no difference.
Because the point here is the fact that it's really, really unusual for it to be retrospective. I've never seen that before in 30 odd years of government. It's just not something that happens.
Okay, turning to audit. This was picked up by an auditor. I'm not sure if it was internal audit or external audit. Could somebody clarify if it was external audit that picked up this issue or was it internal audit?
Sorry, could you clarify which issue?
The issue about the Harvard approval of the 77,000. It was picked up by the auditor, the report says. Is that external auditor or internal?
External.
Why wasn't it picked up by the internal audit team? Is there an internal audit team?
Yeah.
Robin?
There is an internal audit team. And the challenge there is the CEO had chosen to interpret the rules to suggest to himself that he didn't need to refer this to anyone, didn't need to take anyone's advice or run it by anyone. And I would like to say for the individual concerned that the advanced management programme at Harvard is really hardcore to get into. And the fact that somebody proposes a proposal and writes it doesn't suggest somehow they were gaming the system or something. The proposal was put in, the chief executive officer and accountable officer deemed it was appropriate for him to just say yes and put the expense through, which is why internal audit would not have picked it up. And I think this was picked up largely because it was one of a sequence of things that caused the external auditor concerns about decision-making, quality of decision-making by the chief executive.
Mm. But did the organisation, Donald, did your organisation know that that type of expenditure had to be approved by Scottish Government?
Well,
it was over 20,000 pounds.
Yeah, the rules in operation were that the board were not required to be told about that. But the bit that I'm really keen on changing, and it has changed, is where such a proposal comes to the approvals group, which wasn't the approvals panel, which wasn't in operation at that time. That's another crucial change. So the approvals panel would discuss this proposal and have input from all the other directors. So it wouldn't be the chief exec influencing that decision almost entirely on his own. That's an important change. So first of all, the approvals panel is in place to stop that. And the other thing would be that the approvals panel have gone through a series of training courses to enable them to make the decision about whether a proposal is novel and contentious. And that's judgment that I think was wrong in this case, because the CEO at that time, supposing he was very keen on this proposal, should really have said, this is novel and contentious, I should get the approval off the board and the Scottish Government. And that's the bit that was missing and didn't happen. And we're working hard to change that. David, do you want to come in on...
Yeah, so Mr. Coffey, at the time the decision taken was that because an options appraisal was provided, that the threshold, this wasn't deemed a single tender purchase, and therefore the threshold was £100,000 as per the governance framework. However, Audit Scotland, when it embarked on the audit, reviewed the appraisal, didn't find it sufficiently robust, and classified it as a single tender purchase, and therefore the £20,000 threshold was applicable, which then led to the retrospective approval by the former CEO in November last year.
Yeah. I mean, declaring it as an options appraisal, did that somehow give some comfort to making that decision and not seeking the approval? Because it's clearly not a tendered process. An options appraisal isn't a tendered process. Who introduced this notion that it's an options appraisal process and therefore doesn't need Scottish Government approval?
So as at the time, this is why I was making the point around, at the time this wasn't discussed around the group collectively to look at either the value for money case, the procurement approach, or indeed the requisite approvals that then followed. Regardless of whether or not an options appraisal was put forward, or whether or not this was deemed a single tender purchase, it would have been deemed novel and contentious. and should have been put forward for approval to the board and to the government as a matter of course, which gets back to the cultural point, which we are now trying to change within the organisation.
Okay, thank you. Maybe my last question, and this is for you, Roy. I mean, this committee, as you know, over the years has engaged in issues about sponsorship division and its relationship between public bodies and so on and so forth, that this hardly stands out as a great example of the successful relationship that we have. And we've come up against issues time and time again. What would you say to the committee and to the public about the nature of this relationship, particularly between yourselves and this particular body, and what lessons are we learning about the future, and how this has to improve so that we don't continue to meet as an audit committee and pick out these problems year after year?
Yeah, thanks, Mr. Coffey. And you know, firstly, it is unacceptable to be sitting here with a public body that has not complied with the policies that are set down in the framework document. And I think Donald and David have done their best to set out why that has occurred as a result of the former chief executive not complying with those policies. From my own perspective, if I set out the timeline first, so the first I was made aware of this was when Audit Scotland approached me to say, like a quiet word with you on what's about to come forward in terms of a Section 22, and then they then went through that in a bit more detail. Having then surfaced those issues, speaking to Kirsty and John, we immediately moved to speak to Donald on the 11th of the month, and then, you know, conveyed my, I guess, concern, severe concern over what had arisen out of this audit, and cited to the sponsor team. So the sponsor team found out at the same time as the Section 22 report. And I look back at, you know, what more could be done in terms of that sponsor relationship. So here's a body that, out of all my bodies, is one that I would have thought would have been in a really high, efficient, operating way as a commissioner, and clearly wasn't. And we talk about the things that we're trying to put right now in terms of helping Donald and the team get back to that position. But there was regular engagement from John, and supported by Kirsty as the director responsible for the body, on the policy regulation element of the work of the board. Previous accounts hadn't indicated any issues with the board, and that's not a defence, it's just a matter of fact. And I think the attention was probably more on its operation as a technical efficient regulator rather than the inner workings. We wouldn't normally get sight of expenses, for instance, within a public body. We wouldn't normally be party to the policies set up in terms of travel and the likes. Those are matters for the board, as set down in the framework agreement, very clearly what the responsibilities are, linked to the SPFM, again, very clearly on the responsibilities of my role as a portfolio accountable officer and of the chief executive role as accountable officer. And those are pretty clearly set out. And I, in this case, I think there was clearly a derogation from those duties in terms of that accountable officer's responsibilities. Going forward, I think the key thing for us is to re-establish that trust from this committee and others in both the workings of the board, but also how we as a sponsor team, Kirsty and John, and the wider team start to work with the board on improvements. And I'll just say two more things, Mr. Coffey, if I can. The first of those, the discussion I had with Donald in November, I said to him then I would undertake an independent review of governance, and that's being worked through just now in terms of procurement on our side to get somebody to undertake that. We will also look at the sponsorship to make sure we are strengthening as much as we can in that sponsorship role. The public body support unit will provide a dedicated piece of work towards David and the team, again, to try and improve governance as we go forward. And since the 11th, we have had a monthly meeting with Donald and Kirsty and the team to go through the action plan. 24 of the 27 actions are now complete, which is good, but there's more work to do. The culture change is the bit that is going to take the real heart and graft of both the chair of the board and the chief executive to make that cultural change happen and get this back into an even footing. More widely, as a DG responsible for quite a big portfolio and a number of public bodies, On the back of the Ryan review, as you know from what the Perm Secretary has probably said previously on the Ryan review of public bodies, we undertook a couple of new initiatives in terms of how do we try and make sure we get assurance as accountable officers on all our public bodies. The first of those, we were the first, one of two DGs actually, to trial a kind of red, amber, green rating from our lead directors on the state of the public body across a range of questions to just get an idea of whether those were running appropriately or not. That document is something that's discussed at DG Assurance and quarterly meetings that I hold with all our directors, internal audit, external audit, and we review that on a regular basis, as do the directors. We also, on the day that it was told by Audit Scotland off the Section 22 report, I immediately put that out to all our directors in the portfolio to make sure that they, with a clear message that they needed, A, to make sure that frameworks were regularly reviewed in accordance with the guidance, and that they had regular engagement with their chairs and chief executives. It's difficult for me to meet everybody. I try and do it on a cyclic basis. I've got a forward programme of cyclic engagement, but I do that where I can to try and tie up with the work of Kirsty and John, who, and again, under the framework agreement, it's pretty clearly set out that the delegated engagement with the board is through Kirsty, John and the sponsorship team. And then again, I reinforced that on the 20th of December. And since then, I think six times in SMTs this year, I have brought back this issue of public body sponsorship, the importance of making sure that that works right. There is really good guidance available from the public bodies unit, which is cascaded through the teams to make sure that they are following best practice and helping our public bodies to be highly efficient and well operated. But again, it comes back to there are very clearly set out responsibilities in the framework agreement for the chair, the board, the chief executive and the sponsor team. And it would be inappropriate for us to be in about all of the work of the board, because it has been set up as a non-departmental public board in law with particular responsibilities to undertake that.
Roy, just finally, just all of that is really appreciated. But are you saying that what happened here can't happen again? It shouldn't need a quiet word from the Auditor General about something that's happened for the sponsorship team to be aware of something. There has to be some kind of earlier, better, quicker engagement that helps to stop a problem like this arising. Internal audit didn't fail. It was ignored because of other circumstances that the colleagues have described. But you're not being made aware of it until the tail end. That needs to change, the sponsorship relationship.
Absolutely.
Needs to be closer, more engaged in whatever way necessary to
I'll bring Kirsten to say that. But absolutely, that is the case. I think unless these issues are surfaced and brought to the attention of the sponsor body, and as I say, there were regular engagement with John and the organisation, it's difficult for the sponsor body to get to that level of detail. And I think that's the key thing here is how do we learn the lessons out of this so that we help our sponsor teams to ask those difficult, challenging questions so that they can be assured, and in turn I can be assured, that we're doing everything possible to ensure the board is complying, and the chair and the chief executive, complying with what's written down in the framework and in SPFM. Kirsty.
Sorry, we're really running against the clock now, and I'm going to... I know that the deputy convener has got some questions to ask, so I'm going to bring him in now. And if you get an opportunity, Kirsty Berg, you can come in on in response to Jamie's questions. But Jamie Green,
thank you, convener. And some of my questions will give you perhaps some further opportunity to say what you were just about to say. I'd like to start first of all before we look at the wider issues of other public bodies, but on this issue of Wicks itself. I'm new to this committee, and I didn't attend the last session, but I did watch the footage, and I thought that was uncomfortable. This is 10 times worse. What I'm hearing, though, are quite a wide range of issues where, if you worked in that organisation, there were a number of perks, if you like, working practices, free personal eye care, boozy lunches, retail vouchers, expensive training courses at Harvard, business class flights, and so on. And none of that really rings any alarm bells. Anyone that's worked in the private sector will find that that's quite common. That's common practice. That's how businesses work. But this isn't the private sector. And it seems to me like what I'm hearing is a culture of the private sector where you're spending your own profits, you're spending shareholders' money, but in the public sector. So I guess my question is has this organisation been running like a private sector business instead of a public sector body? I'll start with the chair of the board.
Well, thanks. I'll start with the answer to that question. Wickes is indeed a public body, but it is quite different in that it generates 22% of its income from international consultancy. Now, there is a grey area here, and I feel strongly about this point, that we are charged with developing that international consultancy income, which means you have to extend, you have to invest, and that means sending people off abroad to conferences to give papers to build up the reputation, which in fact has been done. And I can tell you that Wickes enjoys a really excellent reputation. We are being continually asked to host visiting delegations from other countries to see how we do it. And I'm proud to say that Scotland has an excellent record in Scottish water and in how it's regulated. And that's what they come to see. And then they ask us often to take part in consultancy. Now, if you recognise that we have an objective of developing international income to supplement that which we have as a levy from Scottish water, and it is quite substantial, then you have to recognise that that means undertaking activities which you wouldn't normally expect of a public body. So I am going to ask for further clarification from Scottish Government on what it is exactly we should be, or what is appropriate then for a public body which is tasked with developing external income. What is appropriate for that body to undertake? Because you're asking staff on one day to be behaving with a potential customer with a lucrative contract, which might lead to extensive income, and then the next day to be adopting perhaps a very low-cost event on a domestic regulation. And that's, frankly, not that easy to do. Now, we have started quite a degree of accounting separation of these activities, and Robin can give you more detail on that. We have started that, and we've had discussions about how we proceed, even to the point of setting up a different legal entity which might be responsible for the international income. But that issue is still, it's still there, and it's grey, and it's something I welcome further clarification from our colleagues in the sponsor team.
Yep.
So I'm looking forward to that.
Yeah, and I've got a lot of questions, so I'm going to just rattle through rather than ask the whole panel to respond, and I'm going to ask for brief responses to them. And I think that is a very valid conversation. The reason I raised it is because we're absolutely right to be sitting around this table and the wider public watching to be outraged at 400 quid boozy lunches and people, you know, flying off first class for training courses.
Never first class.
Well, business class. £5,000 to Boston's quite a lot of money, I would say, looking at the letters. But that's by the by. I think my wider point, though, is that there is a clear inherent conflict of interest between the work that people are doing on the ground, but forgetting that these cards that they're using are using public money. And I think that's where there's clearly some conflicts have to be resolved. I also have a wider issue, having listened to the evidence, in that I read the Commission's annual report, all 75 pages of it, and on page 30 it states, in black and white, there have been no governance issues identified during the year that are significant in relation to Wickes' overall governance framework. Well, if that be the case, then why did the Auditor General say that the Commission demonstrated poor governance, over expenditure, insufficient engagement with its sponsor, and as we've heard, a wide-ranging Pandora's box of failures in governance? So my problem is this: the report is saying that our internal audit processes, and indeed your external audit processes, bear in mind you're paying quite a lot of money to Grant Thornton to do some of this work, and I beg the question what role they've had in all of this. Yet it took the Audit Scotland, the Auditor General, to step in and say, hold on, something smells wrong here. What has gone so catastrophically wrong in you as a board to have missed all these governance issues?
Well, if I could start the answer to that again, convener.
The overall financial management of Wickes, we have a budget which is approved by Scottish Government, and the Board approves. We have regular financial reports to the Board. We have regular audit committee reports back to the Board. We have external audit as well. Internal audit contribute to the ERC. I note, that the accounts were not qualified ever, including the last year to which the Auditor General has reported, on which the Auditor General has reported. And there were no issues found in all the preceding years, in all the 24 years of Wickes. So we are agreed, of course, that we did not demonstrate value for money sufficiently.
But that is one of the four key accountability metrics that you as a Board have to sign off. You signed off each four of them. Value for money is one of them, but there are others. Effective and robust internal controls, high standards of proprietary behaviour. There's a whole list of things that you have to sign off in the annual report. You signed them off, and it's there in black and white. It says no governance issues were identified. If there were no issues, then why did the Auditor General produce a Section 22 report that said there were issues?
Well, value for money. I'm sorry.
Yes, sorry. I mean, so either you knew there were issues and said there weren't in the report, in which case the report was false, or you missed all these issues, in which case, how could you have missed them but Audit Scotland found them?
Could I start with the value for money? In value for money, Wickes has repaid, actually, in each of its four strategic review periods, some money back to Scottish Water. In fact, the last payment was in 2020, £1.5 million. Our costs per household are about the same as Ofwat, and we have made some comparisons of the costs even of our staff, and we do compare well in terms of being lower. So I would suggest that overall, our value for money, I said overall, is good. Now,
my question isn't about any of that. My question is your role and the gentleman sitting to your right as two members of the Board failed to identify any of these corporate governance issues in your annual report. Why?
There's a report that came to the Audit and Risk Committee, which then came to the Board in 23, which highlighted a pilot that had been in place for 6 months on a new expenses policy, and the report was there was nothing to report. It was going well. But I'll pass to Robin to answer that particular question on the expenses policy. But could I just finish, though, my last point? And that is, if you look at our expenses in total, they're actually 3.1% lower than they were 5 years ago. So that's my argument about value for money. But, Robin, I know you want to talk about the expenses.
No, I think we're in the danger of conflating two separate issues. There's audit, and as the Auditor General said in the last session, the audit is a sampling process. You do it risk-based. The Audit and Risk Committee applies similar processes. We look for where we think the big issues are, and I'll come back to 99% of our expenses were properly done. So we were aware of the tensions and the difficulties of managing the expenses. Donald's highlighted, two very different businesses sharing the same house and same set of accounts. And this has been a live issue. This has been discussed at the Board for years. Should we separate? Should we do something different? How can we keep this apart and not allow one to cross-contaminate or cross-subsidise the other? These have been live debates that the Board have had. So we've been working very much on those. So the audits that were done, subject to the sampling that was done and the materiality thresholds, didn't pick this up. Several of the big issues that caused the auditor to be concerned about culture, the Board was completely unsighted. You've heard us talk about that at length. So it's a very unusual situation.
You held 10 meetings in that year, sure. I refer to, five formal, five informal. And there were no issues of culture around the senior directors and the chief executive arose in those meetings?
There were issues around there weren't issues around policy, issues that we identified within ARC. If I speak about my committee, and the Board were aware that there were issues with compliance with policies. And the approach we were taking was on a risk-based to continue tightening the policy as we went forward, continue our scrutiny. We introduced a non-compliance report to highlight areas and to keep every time we could reinforcing how people should behave. Now, if people then choose to go outside and do things away from the sight of the board and not bring them back to the board or bring them back to the Audit and Risk Committee, that's very difficult when you're trying to do a risk-based sampling. You know, the Audit Committee meets four times, it's got a broad remit, we've only so many hours, and that's what we do, and we did our best. And I think those comments are what's reflected in the report, okay? The other things that were happening off to the side, under the table, yeah, it took an audit to find them. And we rely on audit to give us feedback. And I will thank the external audit for unearthing these and joining up some dots and saying, you've got a major issue here, a lot bigger than we thought we had.
It sounds like you've got some work to do on your internal audit, though. And you need to be having a conversation with your internal auditors, surely. If it only got picked up an external audit.
Correct. And based on the policies, based on the governance framework, based on the interpretation of what do I need to do to get this approved by the CEO, none of those flagged up. So internal audit wouldn't have picked those up because they didn't flag up properly. So yes, we have got work to do. Yeah. The internal audit, since this has happened, we've refocused the internal audit from doing what they were doing to really focus on processes, procurement processes, control and finance. So we'll be well prepared for the governance review and any other review, because we've been digging into that ever since the middle of November.
I appreciate time is also against us. I had one specific question. A lot of conversation today has been around the former chief executive who obviously resigned, and it's very easy to make scapegoat of individuals when there are wider systemic issues, and especially if they're not here to defend themselves. But can I ask he clearly didn't resign with a heap of glory given the issues, but did he receive any financial settlement upon his resignation, and if so, how much?
Well, the board had asked the CEO and the executive for a detailed response to the Section 22 report, and we were still considering that response when the CEO tendered his resignation, and he said it was for personal reasons. He'd set up Wix. He'd been there for 24 years, and he said he'd come to the end of what he thought he could do for Wix. And the board decided to accept. And his contract required him to give 6 months' notice, and we agreed that we would honour that, and he resigned on the 31st of December.
With any financial payment?
He was given exactly what he was due legally.
Six months'
salary.
So he was under investigation, but he was clearly under a lot of pressure to respond to a very serious allegation of corporate governance by Audit Scotland. Whilst that process was going on and you were presumably waiting on a response, he handed his notice in. He's required to give you 6 months' notice. So rather than have him hanging around for 6 months, he was allowed to leave, presumably with immediate effect, and a six-month payoff?
It wasn't the payoff. The CEO's contract required him to give 6 months' notice. That would have had him working as CEO and in post for 6 months until June of this year and been paid for 6 months. And he was legally due that. So rather than that, the board agreed to pay him 6 months' salary in lieu of notice, provided he departed at the end of December. Now, we took extensive legal advice and gained approval from the sponsor team for this approach.
Why didn't you make him work his 6 months?
Well,
why is the public funded him to go off and do something else for 6 months?
The agreement to have him depart at the end of December was because we wanted to have a departure date of the end of December. That allowed the board and Wix to quickly refocus on value for money and to produce an action plan that's been referred to in response to the Section 22, and to start the process of appointing both an interim and, in fact, a permanent CEO and changing the culture.
Mr. Brennan, I have one final question, and this is a real cause of concern to me, is that what we've heard today has uncovered within a public body some quite serious issues. Now, you're responsible for, I think you said 28 other public bodies within your directorate. You talked about a new process, which I think is very welcome, this red, amber, green process of identifying bodies that may not be fulfilling their obligations. First of all, would you be willing to publish that for the, in the interest of transparency, so the public can see where there are areas of concern? But do you personally have any other concerns that of the other agencies that are under your control, there may be similar issues which we just haven't discovered because Audit Scotland doesn't have enough time or a big enough team to do a root and branch review of every single public body? Because I would hate to think that what we've seen at Wix is happening elsewhere, but we just don't know about it.
Well, on the first point, I think that's something that I'll need to take away and with the corporate team, because it's done across the whole of the Scottish Government. So all DGs follow that process. So I'll take that away and speak to the DG and corporate and the permanent secretary. On the second point, as I say, I think we have the teams, the sponsor teams, different degrees across the different elements. N4, for instance, we were one of the first to do a stress test with NatureScot, which effectively is a period of time, 2 to 3 years, where in a safe environment, governance, relationships, and the kind of approaches are taken forward. And I think it's a willingness to try and make sure that we use the best practice that's occurring across Scottish Government and rolling that out to other teams. Can I categorically sit here today and say that there will not be another issue that arises in terms of governance? I would like to hope not, and certainly in terms of my approach to this is very much making sure that both I and the sponsor teams and the directors that are responsible for looking after those teams fundamentally understand what's required of them in terms of the frameworks that are in place, but also their duties to this committee, the Parliament and the wider public, and making sure that those boards are operating as efficiently and effectively as possible. And by and large, they do that. I think some of the, a lot of the larger boards, NatureScot, SEPA, for instance, all very, very good in terms of their approach to governance. And I'm sure that Auditor General Scotland will attest to that on those that he audits specifically. As I said before, it's uncomfortable sitting here today, and it's unacceptable that we've ended up in this position. But I think the work that I've now got in place with David and Donald and the board to try and support them in getting back to a position of really high governance organisation will hopefully get us back to this point that the next time you come, you want to see us, we'll be in a better position with some of these issues that have been raised.
I do hope so. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Well, we are out of time, so I'm going to wrap this session up and thank everybody for the evidence that you've given us this morning. You've given us quite a lot to think about. I've just got one very quick final question, which is how much then is the value of 6 months' salary for the chief executive who was paid off at the end of December?
Well, Convener, rather than give you a figure which is not exact, can you allow me to give you that figure in writing?
Yes, I'd rather it was accurate, so yes, I'm happy for that to be the case. Thank you. Okay, so can I thank you for your time this morning, and I'm going to suspend the meeting to allow for a change of witnesses. Thank you. Well, can I welcome everyone back to the Public Audit Committee for consideration of our agenda item 3, which is a Section 23 report on the National Health Service in Scotland 2023. And can I welcome our witnesses this morning in this session? We're joined by the Auditor General, Stephen Boyle. Good morning, Auditor General. Cornelius Chikwama is back with us again for this session. You're very welcome, Cornelius. Good morning. Lee Johnson, who's a senior manager at Audit Scotland, is also joining us, and Martin McLaughlin, who's an audit manager at Audit Scotland. We're a little bit up against the clock this morning, Auditor General, but before we get to questions, could I invite you to make an opening statement?
Many thanks, Convener. Good morning, Committee. I'm pleased to bring you this morning my latest annual report on the NHS in Scotland. My previous reports on the NHS have largely focused on the immediate response to the COVID-19 pandemic, and then plans to move from response to recovery. This report, however, takes a longer-term view, reflecting the need for significant service transformation to ensure the sustainability of Scotland's health services. Health continues to be the single largest area of Scottish Government spending, accounting for around 40% of the Scottish budget. But rising demand, operational challenges, and growing costs have added to the financial pressures upon the NHS, and without reform, its longer-term affordability. Unchecked, there is a risk that Scotland's NHS will take up an ever-growing share of the Scottish budget and therefore less money for other vital public services. In 2022-23, health boards saw the end of COVID-19-specific funding, but some associated costs continued. At the same time, general inflationary pressures, increasing utility prices and higher-than-expected pay deal prices have significantly increased NHS spending. All boards met financial break-even targets in the year, but over one-third of territorial boards needed financial support from the Scottish Government to do so. Seven boards failed to deliver planned efficiency savings, and overall, the NHS remains reliant on one-off savings. Even if ambitious future savings targets are achieved, boards are likely to require further financial support. In addition to financial pressures, Convener, operational performance continues to be challenged. Services are yet to operate in the way they were before COVID, and activity in secondary care has increased, but is outpaced by growing demand. There's also been some progress in reducing the longest waiting times, but key waiting time standards are not yet being met, and overall waiting lists continue to grow, with new patients being added more quickly than existing patients are being seen. The NHS workforce is its single biggest important resource. The staff are reporting under significant pressure and sustained challenges. Vacancies continue to be unfilled, and staff turnover and absence rates are increasing. More bank and agency staff is being used to cover these. Agency staff in particular costs increased by over 25% in the financial year in question. Operational performance and workforce challenges are impacting patient safety and experience. Concerns are being raised in relation to overcrowding, staff well-being, and as I mentioned, the continuing use of bank and agency staff. Financial and operational pressures have contributed to the NHS struggling to implement elements of its 21-26 recovery plan, including these longer-term reforms that are required. The national policy context, Convener, that the NHS operates in is complex, and we set out that much of in our report, with a range of strategies, plans and policies in place, but yet no single overall vision for how health services will look in the future. The absence of this direction is hindering boards' ability to plan and deliver reform at the scale, pace and ambition required. To deliver effective reform, the Scottish Government needs to lead on the development of a clear national strategy for health and social care. It should include investment in measures that address the causes of ill health to reduce the longer-term growth of demand for healthcare, and it should put patients at the centre of these future services. Convener, as ever, we'll do our utmost to answer the committee's questions this morning. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm going to kick off with a question related to that very last point you made, which is your critique that there isn't really a long-term national vision for the National Health Service in Scotland. We've got a new Cabinet Secretary for Health in post, so it's not your job to advise government ministers what to do, But in the context of the job that you do have, what do you think the benefits would be of there being a clear national vision for the National Health Service, and what effect would that have on the ability of boards to deliver the services that we need them to deliver?
Yeah, many thanks, Kabir. You're right, and just for absolute, perhaps on the record, say my role clearly excludes me from commenting on the merits of policy that are in place. However, we do make recommendations in terms of financial sustainability and delivering value for money and improved performance from public services. And that is our assessment that lies at the heart of today's report, that there are many policies, plans, strategies even, and we set out some of a timeline of that in part three of our report over the past 20 years, but no overarching vision. And the reason we believe that is so necessary, as we set out in the report and many other organisations are commenting upon, is the pressure and the challenge that health and social care services are experiencing in Scotland. And our assessment, if we look into the medium term, that we are unlikely to see a significant departure from the circumstances that we are currently in if we do not have this longer term vision about how Scotland's people will remain fit and healthy for as long as possible. Our investment in preventative measures at the expense of the investment that we are making in secondary or reactive and acute settings, and that can move us away from what seems to be a very, very challenging context on the delivery of health service to one that is sustainable and affordable. And if I may just end on a financial note, as we're continuing to see in our own work and drawing on the work of others, notably the Scottish Fiscal Commission, who they themselves are forecasting that without change, we're currently at 40%, but in the years to come, we'll be approaching 50% of the Scottish budget that health spending will consume. And all of that will mean less money for other vital public services. So this applies to the health and social care setting, but much more widely on the need and the case for reform, in my view, Convener.
Thank you very much for painting that bigger picture. I think that's a really useful way to start this session. And I'm going to invite Graeme Simpson to put some questions to you, which really lead on from that starting point. Graeme.
Thanks, Convener. I promise to be brief, because I'm aware of the time constraints. So, Auditor General, your report, it provides a summary of progress by the Scottish Government against the recommendations in your report of 2022. And a third of the recommendations in that report you've made again. So, to what extent are you satisfied with the progress that's been made?
So we think there's more to do here, Mr. Simpson, in terms of setting out clearly the progress against the NHS recovery plan, and that is one that can be measured and is reported. There is clear trajectory from the actions and the intentions of the recovery plan through to what was delivered. I'll pass to Lee in a minute, actually, because I think it'd be helpful for me to set out for the committee what our assessment is of what is a range of measures, statements, but it's quite hard to track from the recovery plan to what's actually being delivered. So hence why we repeat that recommendation in today's report, as we did last year. But Lee, you can say more.
Thank you, Auditor General. We made this recommendation last year, and again, we call again for greater transparency. So the progress report on the recovery plan was published this year, and yet again, it's very difficult to track the progress that is actually being made with some of the commitments and ambitions set out in the recovery plan. So, for example, the additional capacity that was intended, there's no mention of the progress that is being made towards that. We know, for example, that the national treatment centres are pausing. That was one of the key things that were going to offer that additional capacity within the system. And there's no mention of the delays to the NTCs within that update, the progress update to the recovery plan. There's other areas such as the number of people self-presenting to urgent care. Again, that's not being tracked within the recovery plan. And although there is some mention of some of the different things that they've done to try and improve cancer care, for example, the only reference that's made is to the median waiting times to one of the standards, waiting time, cancer waiting time standards, but there's actually no mention of the poor performance in terms of cancer waiting times within the progress update. So yes, we are, we think that it would help to have more transparency around the progress of the commitments and ambitions that are set out within the recovery plan.
Thanks, that's very interesting. I mean, does this come back to a recurring theme that we have in this committee about lack of data?
So that you're right, Mr. Simpson, that has been a feature of many audit reports about the need for better data that allows, and really planning for outcomes. If we go back to an Audit Scotland report from a number of years ago, actually, that when publishing strategies or plans, that public bodies and absolute Scottish Government know how they intend to measure, track, and then report. So there is a very clear issue, and if I may refer the committee back to the evidence and your own reporting on adult mental health arrangements in Scotland, that was a very strong theme that whilst data exists in a more stronger context in an acute and secondary setting, in primary care, there are still data gaps. So there is much work to do there, yes.
Yeah. I mean, it just seems ridiculous that we want to see progress, but as Lee Johnson said, it's difficult to track it. That's an absurd situation. I'm not asking you to respond to that. That's my view. It's absurd. I'm asking about something else. This came up when we were questioning Forth Valley Health Board, and they've obviously had their problems, but they broke even because they received extra money from the government. They were effectively bailed out, and that has happened to other boards. So all boards have broken even. But some of them have had this extra money. And as you've said, Auditor General, there is this over-reliance, as we saw with Forth Valley, on non-recurring savings. I mean, do we have a situation that's essentially not sustainable?
I'll ask Martin to come in a moment, Mr. Simpson, just to maybe sit in more detail how we set in the report. But to address your question directly, that's our belief, that the system in its current guise is unsustainable. And you know, context is everything. So during the pandemic, the committee may recall is that individual boards were supported. So we didn't see any experience of brokerage, the term that the Scottish Government used to provide financial support. As we've come out of that period, we're now back into a cycle that maybe remember from before the pandemic of individual boards experiencing financial challenges, and as they move towards the year end, engaging with the Scottish Government that they're not going to be able to break even, and then a range of individual tailored financial support. So you mentioned Forth Valley, but I think what we're seeing is, as I mentioned in introductory remarks, there were five territorial health boards out of 14 that required brokerage financial support to break even. But you also allude to the wider context, which Martin can elaborate on, is that non-recurring savings remain the vehicle with which health boards use with which to deliver their financial target. This isn't about the more fundamental aspect of system change and evolution in a longer term plan. It's moving from one challenging financial year to another challenging financial year. But bring Martin in to elaborate.
Thank you, Auditor General. Morning, committee. I think it's fair to say that the financial challenges the Scottish Government and individual boards both accept are stark. We saw a reintroduction of brokerage arrangements in 22-23. Ultimately, moving forward, the rationale for setting out the financial support arrangements that the Scottish Government have introduced is an attempt to address these challenges, because under the previous regime, there would be historic issues around brokerage where it would have led to formal escalation. It's now at a point where escalation perhaps would not be by exception. So the support framework is aiming to address that. When it comes to reliance upon non-recurring savings, there is now in place a 3% baseline RRL recurring savings target for boards. You can see in Exhibit 3 that the achievement of savings in 22-23 was proven to be difficult, without preempting what will come from the current financial year, which we're almost at the end of, and the new financial plans that we submitted. You could see that going forward in Exhibit 4, even if the savings were made and those savings that were forecast were relying on non-recurrent measures, there was still a residual deficit that had to be addressed.
Those who will want to come in. One final question from me. Did you look at general practice in your report?
So, fundamentally, no. We haven't made an assessment of general practice in this audit. However, as I refer to in the report, it's my intention to do a wider specific audit on primary care services in Scotland, something that we'll be undertaking over the course of 24, with our reporting date to be confirmed. I may also highlight for the committee's interest that the Accounts Commission, which oversees local government services, of which integration joint boards are part of, will be publishing a performance and financial overview of IJBs in the coming months. But general practitioners will be part of my audit on primary care, Mr. Simpson.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Colin Beattie's got some questions. Colin.
Thank you, Peter. I guess my first question is really about staffing. There's reference in paragraph 25, page 14, about the commitment to increase the NHS workforce over the next 5 years by 1%, which is 1,800 WTE. The NHS is already at a record number of staff, although there's still so many vacancies within that. There's no consideration in that increase of 1% to reflect any reduction in WT hours as the NHS comes down to a 35-hour week. Should that 1% commitment be reviewed in the light of these factors?
I think ultimately it's by policy decisions for ministers, Mr. Beattie, about the size and structure and the number of workers within the NHS. What we know in that paragraph and also in the preceding paragraph is that the number of workers in the NHS, WTE or actual, is increasing. So NHS is experiencing record cash funding levels and commitment for extra staff. But demand is also increasing too. And we're also reporting more widely about some of the pressures that are on Scotland's workforce. If I may address the point, and colleagues might want to come in as well, about the working hours will be a factor. So we've seen in the past few weeks that NHS has moved from a working week of 37 and a half hours to 37, with a direction of travel in due course to a 36-hour week. And then more widely, which referring to in the paragraph you mentioned, of 35-hour week, which is consistent with the Fair Work agenda and the public sector pay policy that sets out the Scottish Government's ambition to move all public bodies and their staff to a 35-hour week. This will have a bearing both on finances, productivity and then outputs. So some real complexity with which the Scottish Government will have to manage to deliver upon this level of growth in the workforce and then changes that underpin it through working hours.
The 1% that's referred to, is that entirely arbitrary or is it based on need?
I'll maybe ask Lee might want to say a bit more about the basis for that and as it relates to how that's delivered through an effective, clear strategy for workforce. You know, we make reference in the report about the need for that clarity. Mr. Beattie, the workforce strategy, accompanied by workforce plans, give government and health boards the real model with which to make these kind of changes. But Lee can say more.
Thank you. The 1% was set out in the National Workforce Strategy for Health and Social Care, which was published back in March 2022. What we have said in the report is we are awaiting an update on progress with that strategy. And as part of that, the Scottish Government have committed to publishing workforce projections based on modelling what the future workforce will look like. So we're still awaiting that. We've been assured that that will be published in spring 2024. I imagine that they might review the 1% as part of that. For example, I've said before, we know that the national treatment centres have been paused. Obviously, there was staff needed for those national treatment centres, and if they are no longer going ahead, then that might lead to a slight reduction in the number of staff required. But until we see those projections and the update on progress of the National Workforce Strategy, we don't know.
So, as far as you're concerned, you're waiting to see the direction of travel down the line as to what's going to happen with this 1% versus the reduction in working week and so forth.
Yes, absolutely. That's a fair assessment. And this is a very complex set of circumstances, no doubt about it. You know, and the number of variables, whether as Lee mentioned, the role of capital investment or in the National Treatment Centre, plans to address waiting lists, growing staff costs in terms of pay deals, drugs budgets, the need to invest in the estate and around Mr. Beattie. So there are a huge number of variables that will need to be fed through, both in the workforce strategy, but I think, as I mentioned in discussion with the convener, as part of that wider strategy about where next.
The crude figure, it's pretty much impossible to tell much about it because we don't know how it's made up. You know, obviously it won't all be nurses. We don't know what the breakdown is, and I presume there isn't any breakdown.
I think really the relevance is, in my mind, is centred on the update to the workforce strategy that Lee mentioned. Until we see that, and that is imminent, is welcome, should give NHS and its practitioners, patients and indeed yourselves that clarity. But so we look forward to seeing that, Mr. Beattie.
Just still on the basis of staff, agency and bank staff, which is a favourite one for us to talk about, the increases in that are pretty eye-watering. I mean, paragraph 26, page 16, you're talking about agency staff costs in 22-23 increasing by 25%, with a 79% increase in spending on agency nurses. This is continuing to go up, and yet every year or every time there's a report, we're assured that they're working on that, they're going to manage it down and all the rest of it, but it doesn't happen. I mean, it's a huge cost to the NHS. Is there any belief that this might reduce in the future? It's such a significant cost.
I think it's probably more a question for NHS leaders than me, but to give you a reliable response, I think what our intention is to, you know, as you allude to highlight that this has been a recurring issue in terms of the delivery of health services, with that was interrupted with controls and relaxations both during and after the pandemic. But what we also draw attention to in the report, and again, I allude to in my introductory remarks, is both the patient experience and in terms of working with agency in particular, not to mention the additional cost that comes with agency workers. So I think whether the national strategy refers to it and address it, we hope that would be appropriate. But actually just looking at the context, the one that's been recurring for many years, Mr. Beattie, is one that's probably best placed for NHS leaders to address.
Okay. I'll move on a little bit to estate management. Obviously, the capital budget that's been available to the NHS for a number of years now has been relatively to other areas of the public service fairly generous. And you know, there's been lots of new building projects and so forth. And paragraph 27, page 16, you say that around 70% of the current estate is in good condition and used efficiently. However, it's likely that there's going to be some constraints on that in the future, given the cuts to the capital budget. Now, you recommend that the Scottish Government develops and publishes a national NHS capital investment strategy to clarify how its spending is going to be prioritised in the future and how the overall estate is going to be managed. Why do you believe this strategy is so important, and do you know whether the Scottish Government intends actually to take this recommendation forward? Are they doing it?
I'll give you my belief why it's important, and Martin might want to update you on what our understanding is the Government's position in accepting the recommendation. If I may actually refer, first of all, to the infrastructure briefing paper that we produced last year, and then the evidence that the committee recently took from Scottish Government officials on this matter. We deliver health services, you know, in safe settings, the buildings, hospitals, GP centres, health centres across the country. So you're quite right, 70% of those are in good condition. But unfortunately, by arithmetic, 30% are not, and that chimes with the over £1 billion of maintenance that's required. Government officials told the committee that in respect of the availability of the capital budget means that they're going to have to make some very difficult choices. That is going to impact on the progress of plans around the national treatment centres. And also a sense that the government is thinking about where to go next. I made a recommendation in that briefing, Mr. Beattie, around the need for a wider review of Scotland's public buildings in respect of the use of not just administrative buildings, but operational assets as well. I still believe that's an important factor with which public services need to be assessed, reviewed as part of government's thinking around reform. And I know that the government's position on this was that administrative buildings remains the focus currently, but health services and the way that we access health services, in my view, will change in the future. You know, and if we are genuine about moving to a preventative model and have a national strategy that underpins and takes us from the position of challenge where we are currently to a more sustainable model, that needs to be more encompassing around a national strategy that also looks at how the NHS and government plan to invest in their estate, so that we can address the challenges of today and be fit for the future. I'll pause, if I may, and bring Martin in just to say about the interaction we've had with government on the recommendation. Martin.
Thank you. Excuse me. I will try and keep it brief. My understanding is the Scottish Government have accepted that recommendation and are currently preparing, as they term it, an asset management and investment strategy. And the underlying point, as the Auditor General outlined, was if there's a lack of new investment and there's already a substantial backlog of maintenance, the ability to address the maintenance by way of replacement isn't there. So in a period where there is a pause in investment, it's very important to look at how you can manage maintenance of the estate, but more importantly, as we alluded to in part three, and as the Auditor General just referred to, boards need to shape and manage their estates to be fit for the future. So there has to be that longer term aspect to the planning, not only to investment and maintenance, but the likely nature of the future estate that will be required to deliver services.
You say the Scottish Government have accepted this recommendation. Did they give any indication as to timescale? I realise it's probably quite a big task.
I believe they've asked for submissions from boards. My understanding is that as part of the 24-25 budget documentation and communication with boards, they indicated that this was being prepared. As to the exact timescales, I'm not 100% clear on.
And they're going to come forward to yourselves once that's in place. Would that be correct? Will they just publish it?
I think it should be one that should be published, that would be my expectation, rather than any liaison with ourselves, Mr. Beattie. But I think, you know, if we have more information on that, we'll come back to the committee, but it's perhaps one for NHS Scotland to address directly with the committee. If I may, actually, I omitted to mention that the other thing to look out for over the next few weeks will be the publication of the infrastructure investment plan that will set out the government's priorities as it relates to individual projects, alongside the medium-term financial strategy for the next few years.
Okay. And just one last question on monitoring and support. You, just before paragraph 37, in the subheading page 20, you conclude there's a need for greater clarity about Scottish Government monitoring and support. This recommendation, what made you decide to make that recommendation? I realise you do sketch out in some of the other paragraphs a bit about it, but what led you to make this recommendation?
So you're referring to the second recommendation that the relationship between new financial engagement arrangements and the support and intervention framework is widely understood ahead of, as Martin's mentioned, the submission of financial plans. I think it really goes to the heart of, I suppose, the financial challenges that are being experienced by NHS boards, that this doesn't lead us into hopefully leads us away from the circumstance we find ourselves in with NHS board funding of a rolling one-year challenge, that we can then move to a more sustainable model of, you know, clarity around investment. And building on some of the work that I think it reasonably referred to, the financial improvement group, the rollout of good practice and so forth, but there's clarity of submission and then what's been asked of individual boards.
Thank you. I'm going to now invite the Deputy Convener to put some questions to you. Jamie.
Thank you. Good morning. I appreciate we're short on time, and this was a very wide-ranging report, so I'm going to focus on very specific areas, particularly around operational performance of the NHS. I think that's the one that affects people out in the public more than some of the other issues. The first obvious one to cover is those of waiting time targets and where we're at with those. And I was, I found it probably makes for quite grim reading, but of the 8 key performance metrics around performance and waiting times, it seems to me from the exhibit, although this is up to September 2023, that none of the targets are being met, and some of them are failing by quite some margin, particularly around A&E treatment times, cancer treatment starting within 62 days, and the 12-week inpatient and outpatient targets. So I just wondered if what your general view is on whether things are getting slightly better, or the long-term trend, certainly from 2018 through to now, has been a trajectory of increased waiting times.
You're right. If Exhibit 8 sets out, Deputy Convener, really the challenges that the NHS is experiencing. Lee might want to say a bit more in a moment, but it really sets out, but I think your assessment of it, that in the round challenges are being experienced, and that's reflecting a deterioration in performance over a 5-year trend, but that there's more of a mixed picture as it relates to performance within the past 12 months, some improving, some deteriorating. It is also, I think, reasonable to say, in drawing on the data and perhaps the Scottish Government's own direct focus, is around, yes, you mentioned A&E performance, but particularly cancer times waiting for initial treatment. And I think just to highlight for the committee's attention, we note at paragraph 46 that cancer in particular is a focus of the First Minister in the 2023-24 programme for government as part of one of the objectives for the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care to improve cancer wait times before patients receive their first treatment. Lee might want to say a bit more about the kind of longer term trend.
Thank you, Mr. General. I don't think things are improving. I think it varies across different boards. We set that out. There is information on our website about the performance of different boards. But for example, the 62-day cancer waiting times target, no board is meeting that standard. The new outpatient appointments within 12 weeks, again, none of the boards are meeting that target. The inpatient and day case treatment within 12 weeks, no board is meeting that target, and the 18 weeks referral to treatment target, no board is meeting that target currently either. And as we say in our report, waiting times are longer and waiting lists are substantially longer than before the pandemic. And although there is some improvement in activity, it is still well below pre-pandemic levels.
What effect does this have on, well, I mean, we know the obvious effect it has on people's general health, waiting for longer to be seen, waiting for longer for treatment to start will clearly have a negative effect on their health. But have we done any analysis of mortality rates, for example? I look specifically at those waiting long periods of time, over a year, over 18 months, and those numbers are very stark. In 2019, there were around 3,500 people in Scotland waiting over a year for outpatient treatment. That's up at 40,000 now. It's a massive increase. And on inpatient treatment, presumably those with quite serious conditions, of the 18-month long wait target, there are only 486, 486 too many, albeit that's up at 17,000 now. So my suspicion and my worry is that not all these people will make it until treatment arrives. Is there any analysis of that?
So extending our work into that analysis, whether of mortality rates or excess deaths, wasn't a feature of our methodology this year, but it has been, I think, particularly during some of our reporting during COVID to explore that. What we've done in today's report is instead to make a kind of broader assessment both on patient experience, which I think, you know, as you're alluding to, and then patient safety in the round, where we draw on the work of Healthcare Improvement Scotland and others in setting out that the experience that people are getting, and in light of some of not just waiting times, but also some of the pressures that are in hospitals, isn't where the clinical experts want it to be. So there is work to do, but I think your wider point is right, and we don't have that data to hand, unfortunately, Deputy Convener, but I'm sure it would be supported by statistical analysis, both in terms of the numbers, but also, regrettably, what is likely to be increased mortality rates as a consequence of longer wait times.
Yeah, and that's obviously very sad. And we're talking about numbers, but we're also talking about people at the end of the day. And you know, people passing away whilst waiting for treatment is sad. And if that's increasing, that's clearly worrying for all government and Parliament. But one of the issues that we talk about often and does come up is the issue of A&E and some of the situations that are arising there. And you've talked in your report about very specific issues of overcrowding in A&E. Ambulances queuing outside and people not being handed over within the 1 hour target. I mean, 1 hour itself is quite a long time to be sitting at the back of an ambulance, but is there any evidence that that's been exceeded by substantial time? We have anecdotal evidence, which we as politicians have access to, but statistically or quantitatively, are we seeing data that supports that? What is the situation in A&E across Scotland?
I'll pass to Lee to update the committee with our understanding. In the report, I think, so any wait times are not being met. I think that's the kind of the high level message to be absolutely clear on, and we set that out in the committee. It is also reasonable to recognise that the Scottish Government and NHS bodies are doing their utmost to address that, and we refer to the work and engagement that they're having with Scottish Ambulance Service to try and improve turnaround times and the extent of waits that people are experiencing, not just in A&E departments, but also, regrettably, in ambulances, queuing to give people, get them into A&E. Before passing to Lee, I think the other thing I would mention, as we say in the report, neither A&E nor ambulances are suitable places for people to receive longer-term care. So there has to be a real consideration and change, if the current arrangements aren't working, to improve the throughput of A&E. But stepping back a second, Deputy Convener, you know, helping people not to get to either planned or unplanned attendance at A&E in the first place. But I'll ask Lee to elaborate as she wishes.
Thank you, Auditor General. So the Scottish Government, as we say in our report, issued new guidance in April 2023 to support the safe and timely handover of patients who arrive at hospital within an ambulance. But I guess, and that guidance states that by August, 100% of patients should be handed over within 60 minutes. But we know that turnaround times indicate that handover within 1 hour is not always achieved, and show that turnaround performance varies across boards. I think I would echo what the Auditor General was saying. There is a lot of work going in to try to address these issues in terms of trying to redirect people both away from accident and emergency to the best place to receive care, but also away from the need to call an ambulance in the first place if there's somewhere better that they can receive care. And then on arrival at hospital, how they're prioritising people who are sometimes queuing in the ambulances. How do we prioritise those people and make sure that the most urgent people are seen first? So there is lots of work going on around trying to reduce that pressure on unscheduled and emergency care.
It's very hard to identify whether... I suppose there are a number of factors at stake here. One is potential volume of people going through the system because it's the only option available to them, and what work could be done around what percentage of those people would immediately be removed from the system if there were other options available, versus delays which are caused by a shortage of staff on the ground at the moment, or as perhaps that third option, which is that throughput of people who, once they have presented A&E, then should be transferred somewhere else, but there is no somewhere else, or the somewhere else is at capacity, so that creates a bottleneck in the system. I presume the answer to that is it's all three are the risk factors involved here, but is there any specific ones you think that immediate action could be taken that would alleviate that situation more quickly, perhaps?
I think it is a combination of all of those factors. As I've said, we know that there is work going on to try and reduce what we call unplanned A&E attendances, so people just turning up, self-presenting, we call it. So there has been lots of different initiatives, flow navigation centres, clinical triage hubs, that kind of thing, to try and make sure that either people are sent elsewhere or that they have an appointment to attend A&E, what we call planned attendance. We do know that the unplanned attendances at A&E are lower than pre-pandemic, but what we don't have data on is how many people are now turning up as planned attendances. So using those other initiatives such as flow navigation, some people will turn up with a planned appointment, but there isn't currently the data to understand how many unplanned and how many planned attendances there are. We know the unplanned, we don't know the planned attendances, but we do know that Public Health Scotland are working on trying to make that data available and robust.
I should declare an interest, convener, having gone through that process of having a planned A&E appointment. Was news to me, but it seemed to work reasonably well. I wanted to just finally, in the interest of time, look at Appendix 3. Obviously, I may be new to the committee, but I'm aware that you've produced previous reports into the NHS and made very specific recommendations to the Scottish Government. Appendix 3 contains 9 key recommendations covering a wide range of areas for consideration. My analysis of this shows that of the 9, 5 are in progress, 3 have demonstrated limited progress in your view, and 1 has made no progress at all, with none of them having completed those recommendations. Is that a normal state of affairs when you're down the line? Is there any... Are you, without giving personal opinion perhaps, but are you content that the direction of travel is a good one, particularly around the issue of the NHS recovery plan, which clearly is an important one post-pandemic, which shows no progress, and how you've reached that conclusion?
I think I would say, and I sort of deputy convener, that these are complex, sometimes intractable issues that we're dealing with, and our recommendations are designed, and I think, and probably I would characterise today's report on the same basis, that to acknowledge that the system has to change to move to a more sustainable model, and that our recommendations are along those lines. So some are in progress, there's some limited progress. Some aspects will be quite direct things that we think can happen now, whether it's transparency or in progress around the recovery plan. And others, even looking at the recommendations, the 10 or so that we make in today's report, will require action over a number of years, assuming that, Martin's mentioned one of them, but that the government accepts the recommendations in the round. So I think there's some mitigation that these are complex circumstances, But as the convener asks, you know, should the committee choose to take evidence about whether the government accepts the recommendations or not, in the event that they do, we would expect thereafter to see a clear programme and a plan to implement the recommendations. And I think today's assessment is one of, in the round, limited progress versus last year's RICS.
And just briefly, is there an inevitability that the health budget will reach 50% of all Scottish Government spend? It sounds like a massive figure, perhaps one that the public isn't even quite aware of sometimes. Or is that something which could be prevented?
I think there isn't. I don't believe there should be an inevitability about it. I think what I'm recommending today is that there's an intervention so that there is a more sustainable, affordable model. I know you're short of time, convener, but I think it's an important point is that the government's own assessment with the experts, so it engaged with the OECD in terms of its approach around realistic medicine. And that assessment says that around 20% of spending on healthcare doesn't lead to improved health outcomes. So the system that we have is the system, but it doesn't mean that that should be the only way that we deliver health and social care services. It's absolutely appropriate that, you know, with the support of Public Health Scotland and the government, that they are looking at a three horizons model. But have a plan. I think that's the clear, you know, have a vision and a plan to move from an unsustainable system at the moment that avoids the need for an ever-growing health and social care budget at the expense of other vital services, Deputy Convener.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm now going to invite Willie Coffey to put some questions to you. Willie.
Right, thanks, Convener. Just on the issue about performance there, having spoken to Ayrshire and Arran's Chief Exec just only last week on the specific target, the 31-day target for cancer treatment, she was saying that Ayrshire and Arran does continue to meet that 95% level, and actually it was 100% in November, so I don't know whether there's a little discrepancy in the data gathering period for the report, Stephen, but that was clearly what she said to me last week.
I'll ask Lee to comment on that, Mr. Coffey. Actually, I think, as Lee mentioned, that we don't set it in today's report, but it's included as a link to our website, a more detailed regional assessment. I think, drawing on the source for our reporting, Appendix 8, we cite Public Health Scotland as being the source on a national basis. And just for completeness, it reports that between September 2018 and September 2023, the performance dropped from 81.4% to currently 72%. How that relates to the information you've had from NHS Ayrshire and Arran, we can certainly check, and if Lee doesn't have that detail to hand just now.
I don't have the exact data for Ayrshire and Arran, but I think the point we're making there is that some boards are struggling to meet that target. It's just below target there, as you can see, at 94.9, and the target is 95. So, but that slight reduction is because there are about, I think, four boards who are struggling to meet that target.
I just thought I'd mention that because it was a positive side of what she had to describe last week amongst a range of these indicators that are of interest to the members. Auditor General, your predecessors, Caroline Gardner and Bob Black before her, I remember them both saying to this committee over several years the need for service redesign and transformation. And we know that the demand on the NHS is going through the roof at COVID, and it's not dissipated yet. Are your recommendations for the service redesign transformation that you're urging the government to embrace changed in any way since from then till now, would you say, is the model that they saw in terms of service transformation the same as what you're recommending now, given that huge change in demand that we've seen in recent years, would you say?
So I would recognise the point you made, that certainly my predecessors have made similar recommendations and views known about the unsustainability of health and social care services. I fear that we're in a more acute setting today, Mr. Coffey, than we were under previous Auditors General when they were in post. How to discharge the recommendations is ultimately a matter for NHS leaders and the government. But I think there's enough evidence before us of, you know, whether it's A&E wait times, more general performance targets, and the financial implications of not change, that makes a strong case that the model that we have isn't sustainable. And I think these are reasonable estimates that the Scottish Fiscal Commission is making, that of course policy choices can lead to that we'll spend as much as we need to on health and social care services, but the opportunity cost will be severe for other parts of public service delivery.
Okay. Hopefully three very brief questions. One on delayed discharge that you cover in the report, and you talk about the Glasgow and Clyde model, Glasflow. Could you just give the committee a wee glimpse of what does that mean, and is that having an impact on reducing the problem that we have with delayed discharge?
Yeah, I'm going to pass straight to Lee on this one. In paragraph 68, we set out the plans that NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, along with their IGB partners, are taking forward.
I guess the best way to describe it is it's a continuous flow model. So it's having a regular schedule of patients who move from A&E into inpatient wards and the planning that goes on behind that, so that you have a continuous flow of patients. But that obviously relies on the beds being available. But again, it's about that continuous flow of discharges as well are part of that. There are a number of boards using a similar model, but I think it is important to point out that Glasgow said it's not a magic bullet. You need to have all the bits lined up. But what it has created is greater partnership working and joint working across the hospital system to use that continuous flow model, and they have seen some benefits from it in terms of getting people out of A&E quicker into hospital beds and ensuring that their discharges are happening when they should be happening.
What I was just going to say is that getting them out the door at the other end quicker back into the community or where they're supposed to go, is it succeeding in that regard?
I think in certain wards it is, but as we see in our report, delayed discharges remain stubbornly high across the NHS in Scotland.
Related to that issue, convener, the Chief Exec, Ayrshire Arn, also said one of the issues that affect that, interestingly enough, is power of attorney and families granting that and getting that permission, that power to deal with that. That affects over half of our discharge cases, she said. Is that common throughout Scotland, do you think? And is it something that we should highlight much more to try and encourage the public to embrace that?
It's such an important point, isn't it, actually? And I think we set out, following paragraph 69 there, really, this was consistent from the three case study boards. So we worked with individual boards when preparing the report, just to test our theories and progress, to hear of their experience to shape the reporting, Mr. Coffey. And both power of attorney and also complementary anticipatory care plans were one of the preventative measures that they said makes a big difference. So if somebody falls ill unexpectedly, a relative don't have power of attorney or don't know what the patient's wishes are, there's inevitably a delay in consultation and engagement with families to better understand. So if what feels like a relatively small step was the feedback, that could make a big difference, yes.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for that. Just turning to staffing, demand versus the ability to staff that demand, Auditor General, and you mentioned the clear difficulties that we have there. What more can we do? What more could the government do to try and close that gap? We know that the demand is increasing year on year, but we do have difficulties in getting the right numbers of staff and health and social care to meet that demand. What are your recommendations there for the government and how to try to help?
Yeah, certainly. So we've made a recommendation in terms of a clearer republished workforce strategy that Lee has mentioned. But it's complex. I would recognise this, Mr. Coffey, that ambitions to increase the NHS workforce are one thing. So finding the right people to staff vacancies. Keeping the people that you have safe and healthy as members of staff in terms of their well-being. We mentioned already this morning about workforce conditions, working hours will be a factor in that. But also I think it's that fundamental point about the environment that people are working in. We reference it in our own report, and certainly listening carefully to the commentary that's come from NHS professional bodies since publication. They are very clear about how challenging, stressful and difficult an environment it is for people who are working in the NHS currently. Giving members of staff confidence to raise concerns in terms of whistleblowing are all relevant factors, and we set a number of these out in today's report. But I wouldn't want to be glib, Mr. Coffey, and say that a strategy will resolve this. I think this is a multifaceted approach that NHS leaders, in partnership with their staff, will need to take so that they can get to a sustainable model of service delivery.
And lastly, from me, Convener, on the opportunities that digital transformation can offer us. Stephen, you've mentioned that in the report too, but are there blockages throughout the system that do you think the digital e-health strategies or telehealth or whatever, in terms of how we embrace digital technology, can help unblock some of the queues that people face, whether that be in GP contact services or consultation services? Do you see more opportunity for that, and are we embracing enough of those opportunities at the moment to help us?
So Leo will want to say more, I'm sure. I haven't looked at this closely during the audit, and it's been a recurring theme in terms of adoption of technology to support transformation, to perhaps to give people access to services outside of a hospital setting, to allow people to to access remote consultations with GPs. And that's all well and good. I think, and perhaps of interest to the committee before passing to Lee, is that we're looking at this outside, specifically the context of the NHS, as part of future audit work. We're currently undertaking an audit of digital access or digital exclusion arrangements that just explores in a bit more detail some of the pace of change, the adoption of technologies, and people are brought along at the right pace, Mr. Coffey, of some of these changes. But specifically in terms of the NHS, I'll bring Lee in.
Thank you, Auditor General. I think, it's a range of outcomes for different things. So we've seen the real impact of Near Me and the difference that is making, particularly within our more remote and rural areas, and the access that's giving people. But I think, as we say in our report, boards have a bit of choice about some of the different things, innovations that they adopt. And I think we need to have greater monitoring and reporting, I think, to determine how the digital programmes and innovations are being adopted, but also the difference they're making. If we can show the difference that they're making, how effective they are, how they're perhaps driving efficiencies, for example, then we might be able to encourage more boards to willingly adopt different innovations going forward. And we do make that recommendation within our report.
Do you find that patients are receptive to using digital technology if they think it will maybe get them seen or heard a wee bit quicker? Are they quite open and easy with that, or would they still prefer the face-to-face direct
I think it I think it varies. Cornelius might want to say a bit more. Look at some of the stuff at the moment, but it's a mixed picture. Is that fair?
Yeah, I think it was something we looked at specifically in terms of patients' response to digital technology. But the general picture from the work that we have done is, there are opportunities that digital offers to respond to the short-term operational challenges, but some of the longer-term as well. I mean, would highlight the Scottish Government and COSLA's digital healthcare strategy, which is, trying to make progress in some of these areas. The key risk that I think has been identified around that is around capital budget, the ability to have enough funding to roll out those digital options at scale. So that is one of the risks around digital that we are highlighting in the Auditor General's report.
Okay. Thank you very much for those. Back to you, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Just a final question really from me, and that's on leadership, and especially at kind of health board level. First of all, you mentioned in the report, I think, that there are 4 out of 14 territorial boards that will be looking for a new chief executive. I think that number might have gone up, actually, since the date of report. But I think the point is, how much succession planning is there? people, I mean, the impression we get on this committee is that people, you know, move around from board to board. I mean, is that too narrow a focus for recruitment for those senior positions? You know, could other parts of the public sector be looked to, and do you have a view on that? And then the second part of my question is about the non-executive board members. I mean, we've looked in some detail at the NHS Forth Valley experience, where there's been a whole governance review and some, you know, fairly substantive recommendations have been made and people have moved on and so on. I mean, do you have a view about the recruitment, the standard of people that are coming forward for non-executive posts, whether the training that they receive is sufficient to equip them to do the very important job that they've got? I mean, in the end, they are responsible for a huge part of that 40% public expenditure, potentially rising to 50% public expenditure in Scotland under the devolved budget anyway. Auditor General, on those questions.
Many thanks, Convener. So you're right, there is real change in terms of the executive leadership, first of all, at some boards. The NHS leadership, NHS Scotland, are not incited on this level of change. And I think one point we would recognise that they're addressing in terms of some of their approach to succession planning, developing programmes around how to identify future leaders, supporting them to make the transition into what are very challenging roles. And I think the predecessor committee, as I recall, looked into this matter in a bit of detail a number of years ago and held round tables around NHS leadership, the attractiveness, what are the factors that are relevant. If anything, it's more challenging now than it was in that context with COVID and all the other factors we've touched on over the course of this morning. So there is an onus absolutely on the NHS in Scotland to make sure that they are giving the right support, setting the right conditions, and then creating the environment for people to thrive. I think they recognise it, but it's clearly that there is work to do, if only borne out by the arithmetic convener about the vacancies and turnover that's in place. Briefly on the role of executives, absolutely. And the good governance has to be, non-executive, I should say, has to be absolutely fundamental in this setting. Work is underway. The final section of the report looks at the blueprint for good governance, and that gives a framework for the non-executives to discharge their responsibilities. In terms of how they identify people, are they bringing the right people in? We haven't looked at that specifically. We know that there's been a degree of turnover at NHS Forth Valley and some other boards, so it's probably too early to make an assessment. But the work of the public appointments team is crucial here, that they, under the direction of ministers, they know who they're getting, they know what skills they're looking for, and then there's a full assessment process in place. Paragraph 126 makes a passing reference to this, convener, that there are plans in place around this, including that external review of board governance, so that the Scottish Government has that level of assurance that its sponsorship requirements are being discharged appropriately, and it's one we'll keep under close review.
Okay, well, look, thank you very much indeed. I'm sorry there was an air of rushness to that session, but it's a very comprehensive report, as the Deputy Convener remarked, and I think it's given us quite a lot of evidence which we'll need to consider what we do with, and whether there are further people we might want to invite to give us their view of what you've found in this annual Section 23 audit of the National Health Service. So, Auditor General, can I thank you very much for your evidence this morning. Cornelius, Lee and Martin, thank you as well. And I'm now going to move the committee into private session.